We're going to look today in Genesis 26, 34. Esau took two wives. Why are we talking about Esau, 40 years old, and getting married to two women? Well, let's see if we can find out. Genesis 26, 34. And Esau was 40 years old. So Isaac was 100. Esau was 40 years old when he took to wife Judith, the daughter of Beeri the Hittite, and Bashemath, the daughter of Elon the Hittite, which were a grief of mind unto Isaac and to Rebekah. In Ephesians chapter 5, there is a phrase that we can repeat without any trouble. We let it roll off our lips because we have memorized it. But it is very important to the understanding of why these last two verses are tacked on to such a glorious thing as the patriarchs of God dealing with the Philistines and all that they had to go through. It is very important, after we have seen the Philistines covering up with earth, and doesn't the religious world try to dump worldliness on your source of water? And then God showing Isaac a well of the oath, Beersheba, and seeing the glory of God in that living water as they digged in the valley. Here we are now studying about Esau and the grief of soul to the rest of the family. Don't think, dear soul, that everything that happens to you as far as trial is going to be from the world. The Bible also says, your foes shall be they of your own household. Now we have a domestic trial. Just in case you think that everything's all fine with you, you're going to have to understand that not only is there famine in the promised land, so that which God promised does not support you, because you've got to learn to have the sentence of death in yourself, that you might not trust in yourself, but in God who showeth mercy. It's not the promised land that supports us, it's the God of the promise that supports us through the land. And that's not all there is. God drives Isaac out. He has to go into the land of Philistines. God blesses him so much there with physical blessings, 100-fold that he gets from his planting, so that he is turned into a great man. That's what it says. He turned into a great man. But it made the Philistines envious. So we're out of the land of promise. It won't support us. We're cast upon God. It doesn't make any sense. The just shall live by faith, not by sense. Dear soul, it doesn't make any sense. Jesus said, man said, I can't see, so he put mud in his eyes. Does that make any sense to you? Does it make any sense that God said, if you want to go up, you got to go down? He that will exalt himself shall be abased. Mr. Otis would never, ever have sold one elevator if you got in, punched up, and it went down. But that's what Jesus does. So we find that he's cast out of the land of promise. He's in the land of the Philistines. God doesn't start off blessing him spiritually there. He blesses him physically. But all that does is make the Philistines envious of him and drive him out from where God told him to stay. Now, what do? The king of the Philistines said, go from us. God said, don't go anywhere. The Bible said in 26:6 of Genesis, he dwelled in Gera. The Philistine king drove him out of Gera. Where'd he go? To the valley of Gera. He didn't really leave Gera, but there was a deeper, more trying place that God would have him to be. So what do you do when you get to the valley of Gera? Start digging. You can scratch the surface in the land of Philistines and get bread, But if you want the water, you got to dig. You can memorize your Bible. You can memorize the books of the Bible. You can be so intellectually religious that all the other religious people who are not saved can't understand your dedication and your devotion to this book. But all you got is letter of the law. You're going to have to dig in the valley to find the Holy Ghost. Until you don't have anything to trust in except God, you're never really going to understand what salvation in Christianity is all about.
Amen.
Now, here we go. Esau gets married. Well, aren't weddings supposed to be a joyful time? It wasn't here. God brings us now to make you understand what this thing is all about. God had made them understand that they were not to involve themselves in the fellowship with the Canaanites. They knew that. Hold on your place. We'll come back to Ephesians in just a minute. Genesis 24. Verse 3 and 4. We're coming back to Ephesians. I told you I didn't know what I was doing. We're just going to follow whatever the Lord brings to mind. Abraham calls his servant, his eldest servant. Put your hand under my thigh, place of procreation. Verse 3, Genesis 24:3. And I will make thee swear by the Lord. How many capital letters in that word? All of them. The God of heaven and the God of earth, that thou shalt not take a wife unto my son of the daughters of the Canaanites among whom I dwell, but thou shalt go unto my country and to my kindred and take a wife unto my son Isaac. It's very important. Now, Ephesians chapter 5. You think that he is giving the preacher something to preach on. On the consecutive Wednesday nights, as he said, we're going to start studying on the home. And he goes to Ephesians chapter 5, and he starts with wives in verse 22, and on he goes. But that's not exactly what this is all about. Verse 25, husbands, love your wife. Next two words.
Even as.
Here we go. You say, she's my wife. Well, I don't know so much about that unless she's a representative of Christ's church first. And for you to relate to her, you're telling everybody this is how Jesus relates to the church.
Sure did get quiet in here.
As the husband relates to the wife, he's to enter into this thing with an awareness and a dedication and an understanding that I am to represent Jesus Christ, and the way I treat her is the way that I want the world to understand and know that's how Jesus treats his church. In other words, your children, your grandchildren, your neighbors, your friends, everybody around you says, he is a picture of Jesus Christ dealing with his church as you see him in his marriage. Whoa, dude. Hey, that's kind of heavy, ain't it? Let me read on. Even as Christ also loved the church, and for God so loved the world, he gave. You can't love without giving. You can give and not love. You can give him a trinket you brought down at Jared's. He went to Jared's. And not have a shred of love in your heart for her. Let me ask you this. If you had to tell somebody that didn't know anything about John 3:16, what would you tell them that word gave meant that God did? For God so loved the world that he gave. Who, first of all? His only begotten son. Stay with me. This ain't hard. He gave his only begotten son. Now stop right there. How did God give his son? Death. Well, did you hear old so-and-so got married? Yeah, he got married last month. Well, what's he doing now? Well, he bought him a pickup truck and a pack of hunting dogs, and she ain't seen him since. Well, old Susie got married about a month or two ago. Well, how's she doing? Well, she got married, got that ring on her favor, and boy, she's putting them mashed potatoes on her plate now. No more dieting for her. She's got her man, and brother, she's got them credit cards, and she keeps them melted. Come on.
Right.
There's not that many people in America understands. Paul says, better for a man not to touch a woman. Don't get involved with them unless you are willing to say, look at me, I represent Jesus Christ on the cross as I live with my wife. That's why this thing's so heavy over here, these last two verses, chapter 26. All right, and gave himself, not he gave something to her. Well, I bought her a new dress last Christmas. No. She didn't marry the dressmaker. She married you, mister. You got to give yourself. Oh. Well, I got these ambitions out the window. I got these routines and things I like to do. I'm sorry. Does Jesus treat you the way you treat your wife? I'll see you later. I know you don't want to hear no more of this. Can you say, world, look at me, I am a representative of Jesus Christ in his relationship to the church, and you need to get saved because look how I'm doing. You know you want to get saved if you see how I'm handling my home life. Ain't many people want to get saved if we are what is the only example. He loved the church and gave himself for it. Why? For her good. Love seeketh not her own. Well, I love you, honey. Well, you know, you can take your Valentine card back because, you know, love seeketh not its own. And if it wasn't for Mother's Day and my birthday and Christmas, I wouldn't ever get nothing from you. I'm trying to represent you, ladies. At least you can smile at me. Do like this when you don't want to say amen, do this. I see you. Might help me out. Quit throwing me an anchor. Give me something to float me with up here. Listen, as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it. Why? That he might sanctify and cleanse it. It is the responsibility of Christ to sanctify and cleanse the church. It's the responsibility of the husband to bring edification upon her with the washing of water by the word, that he might present it to himself a glorious church. He don't want her presented to him without her glory. If you suffer wrongfully, the Spirit of glory and of God resteth upon you. Honey, I know you're going through a time. I know you have problems. I know this, that, and the other, but I just want you to know I'm with you in this. Present her to himself, a glorious church. What is a glorious church? It's not having spot or wrinkle. Not talking about your makeup and looking at your mirror. It's talking about your spirit and your soul and your mind. Washing of water, get rid of spots and wrinkles spiritually or any such thing. But that it should be holy and without blemish. So ought men to love their wives as their own bodies. He that loveth his wife loveth himself. Why? Because you two are one flesh. You need to at least quit driving off till she's got that other foot in the car. For no man ever yet hated his flesh, nor but nourished and cherished it. Watch it now. even as the Lord, the church. For we are members of his body. You are a bride too, mister. You're part of a bride. You're members of his body and of his flesh and of his bones. For this cause shall a man leave his father and mother and shall be joined unto his wife, and they two shall be one flesh. Hold your place. 1 Corinthians 6:17. Coming right back. 1 Corinthians 6:17. Now, don't go throwing rocks at me today now, because you've got an Easter sermon that sounds like, you know, Bible study course in the basement of the church on a Thursday night. This is where we come to. I'm just trying to be faithful to the Lord. 1 Corinthians 6:17. You read it. You ready? Go. That's kind of pitiful. You want to try it again? All right, rub your eyes, clear your throat. All right, go.
But he has joined unto the Lord in one spirit.
Now, what did Ephesians 5:31 say? A man that's joined to a woman is one flesh. So there's no difference. It is a kind of marriage. There's three levels of marriage. When you're first born, there's the marriage of the body to the soul. If you take a wife or you receive her husband, there's the marriage of the wife to the man. But the greatest and highest degree of marriage is the marriage of the spirit to God, the marriage of soul to God by the Holy Spirit. So each and every degree of marriage that's lesser teaches you about the degree of marriage that is the greatest. Now we're getting to it. You ready? In verse number 32 of Ephesians chapter 5, would you read me the first five words?
This is a great mystery.
What's the fourth word?
Great.
Now, tell me something else that is a mystery. You say, well, Paul said the gospel was a mystery. But he didn't say it was a great mystery. This is greater than the revelation of the gospel. This is a great mystery. You think I've been talking about a man and a wife getting married. Listen at the rest of verse 32. But I speak concerning Christ and the church. Wow. Everything about marriage is taken care of except this. Did you get the caterer? Oh, that's the first thing I did was tie him up, because you know how good him and her cook, and we wanted them, and we nailed them down. Even before you asked me to marry you, I knew you was going to ask me, so I went ahead. Did you get the dress? Yep. Did you get the hall? Yep. Did you get the preacher? Yep. You got the photographer? I got it. Did we leave anything out? No. Here's the tickets. 10 cans are tied on the back of the car. Bird seed, not rice. We know better than that. But what about the greatest mystery in the scriptures? Brother Gene, it's so common to us that it's become common to us. This is a great mystery. But I speak concerning Christ and the church. Now let's go back and read Genesis 26 and verse number 34. And Esau was 40 years old when he took to wife Judith, the daughter of Beeri the Hittite, comma. Wait a minute. Supposed to be a period there. In the beginning, it was not so. God only married one man to one woman. He said, comma, and Bashemath, the daughter of Elon the Hittite. And then it says, as blatant as that was, and as common as he made it, it just got up the nose, as they used to say, got in the face of Isaac and Rebekah. Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 16. I got my brush out. I'm painting you a picture. Brother Gary did that with our Bible study. If you did what he said and kept the last passage in mind while he read the next one, you saw the progression of the portrait being painted of Christ. Verse 16 of Hebrews chapter 12, verse 15, looking diligently lest any man fail of the grace of God. You can't have grace to fail. It's that this man fail of the grace. It's not the grace failing. It's the man failing. Lest any root of bitterness springing up trouble you, and thereby many be defiled. That's Isaac and Rebekah and all the rest of the bunch. Lest there be any, next word please.
Fornicator.
Or next two words. You got anybody in mind? What's the next two words after that? Oh my goodness. Before we even start, we're now coming to the place of Esau's motivation. He is a son of Samson. What do you mean by that? Samson looked upon a Canaanite woman and he told his mom and daddy, get her for me, for she pleaseth me well. Wait a minute. Didn't he wind up getting his eyes poked out, his hair cut off, and committing suicide? Yeah. Did he have a good end? No. He was a playboy prophet. Wasn't this what got us in trouble to start with way back yonder in Genesis 6? Yeah. We looked at it in just a minute. Lest there be any, number one, fornicator, or number two, profane person. And who'd you say it was? As
Esau,
who for one morsel of meat sold his birthright. He is a worldly, hungry individual. He gravitates towards the world in everything. You got a spiritual birthright, a right of birth, so that you get the double portion from God. The blessing of the Father is honored by God himself and it comes down on you. Yes. Do you want it? No, I'm hungry. He don't care about spiritual things. He wants to satisfy his appetite. Paul said, whose gods are their bellies. He said they were sensuous. What does sensuous mean? I don't need Webster to look that up. The next phrase in the Bible said, having not the Spirit. So here is one. He's in the middle of the elect family of God. Here is a tare among the wheat. And God would tack it on. It shocked me. First of all, because I'm supposed to preach. And I didn't know how in the world it got there. Moses, what's wrong with you, man? You shouldn't have stuck this right here. We just got through talking about how Isaac had a well and he dwelt at Beersheba and it was everything going along fine. Then bam, you put this Esau thing in on us. It's right where it's supposed to be because you're not going to have any of the blessings of God without the afflictions of the cross. You sing it. What does the song say? I must needs go home.
Right away.
There's no other way but this. So here it is. Dear soul, if you think that being a Christian is just being a member of a church and studying the scriptures, you're wrong. Sometimes, have you ever heard anybody say, what they do speaks so loud I can't hear what they say? How in the world can all these Christians scream and yell and carry on, married couples, till they turn the last corner and come to the church, and then all of a sudden, everything's fine. But you know what? We ain't fooling God. In this message today ain't just about marriage. It's about hypocrisy. It's about trying to act like you're all right in the face of everybody, but then not being right in the face of God. It's about either get in or get out. It's about do it right or get out of it. That's what it's about. That's why God gave us this. Now, Esau looked at these women and decided by his lust, he's a fornicator, he is moved by his lust, that he wants them. And America's idea today is, if it feels good, do it. It's consenting adults, ain't it? We're already in hell in America and don't even know it. Genesis chapter 6. Isn't this how the entire human race got destroyed? This was the same thing Esau is getting into. Genesis chapter 6 and verse number 1. And it came to pass, when men began to multiply on the face of the earth, and we're not just talking about men, males, we're talking about human beings. When human beings begin to multiply on the face of the earth, daughters were also born unto them. And the godly line of Seth, the sons of God, did what Samson did. He saw the daughters of men, the ungodly line of Cain, that they were fair. You know why? Because man looketh on the outward appearance. And America is geared towards good looking and rich. Amen. Then I want you. You may have to live with it then, sir. And it may not be so pretty on the inside. You know, you can hook your arm with her and put that piece of cake in her mouth, her in yours. But wait till after the photographer's gone and you got to pay for the pictures and all that stuff. You wait, you know, till you give her first credit card. You wait till he gets his first pickup truck and his hunting dogs. That's all she wrote, Jack. Some of us, the only reason we got married anyhow was the same thing as Esau, lust of the flesh. And some of us, because our mama wanted grandchildren. That's another story. And the sons of God saw the daughters of men that they were fair, and they took them wives of all they chose. And the Lord said, nothing else to prompt and motivate this feeling and saying of God, my spirit shall not always strive with man, for that he also is flesh. It was his flesh that made him look upon the fair daughters of the line of Cain. Yet his days shall be 120 days. God begins to look at the wickedness of man, verse 5. He sees that their heart is only evil continually. And then he says it grieves him in his soul that he has made man because of what? Improper marriage. Improper attitude regarding marriage. Why? Because marriage is a blank mystery.
Great.
Not everybody in the world has Bibles. These men over yonder in Africa, big old tall black men, living in grass-covered huts, they don't even know what a Bible is and couldn't even spell cat if you tried to get them to. These people all over this whole world never will have a Bible to hear the gospel, but ain't none of them without being married. That's how God's going to be able to say to the entirety of the human race, if they say, well, you didn't tell me, I wasn't born in the Bible Belt in America, don't make no difference. Did you take that woman? Yep. Guilty. It's the great mystery. Nicodemus, you ought to know about being born again. Ain't you married? How come you don't know this and you're a master in Israel? Don't you understand about birth? It takes two. the man has to penetrate and plant the seed. The woman has to fertilize that seed and bring it forth and reproduce and bring it forth out of her own body. That's the way the Holy Spirit works. The sinner's in darkness. That womb's in darkness, has no ability to do anything of itself to bring forth any life. Darkness is upon the face of the deep. And God said, the word comes in, penetrates the darkness of that sinner's soul, implants Christ within him, impregnates them with Christ, and he bursts forth Christ by the fruit of the Spirit. That's salvation. What is that? The great mystery. And it repented the Lord that he had made men on earth, and it grieved him at his heart. So isn't Isaac, are not Isaac and Rebekah doing God's part? What are they doing in Genesis 26 and verse 35? Which were three words. Grief of mind. Did you ever stop to think that some of the things that grieve you as a born-again child of God are there because they grieved God first and he's letting you enter into the fellowship of his sufferings? Why do you grieve over sin? You didn't before you got saved. You jumped in the middle of it like a hog in the slough. But now, it grieves you. They're doing what God did about improper marriages. And what God did was kill every man, woman, boy, and girl, and every animal except those that could fit in that ark that God called in and put them inside that ark to preserve life. That's why this is put here. That's why this is here. Look, if you will, to chapter 27 of Genesis. In verse 41. Okay, we're home from the wedding. First thing she does, probably in the car. But especially when she gets in the door of the house, is kick him shoes off. And he starts undoing that tie if he ain't already done it. And say, I got to get out of these clothes and get in something I'm comfortable in. And guess what? Then the fun begins. Well, we got him married. That's our last one. We got him married. Got her married. We done got rid of him. No, you ain't at the end of it. You just at the beginning of it. Genesis 27:41. And Esau hated Jacob because of the blessing wherewith his father blessed him. And Esau said, where?
In his heart.
The days of mourning for my father are at hand. Old man's going to die pretty soon. And guess what I'm going to do? Soon as my father dies, Jacob's going to die too. I'm going to kill him. Isn't that what the boy said in Egypt? Joseph, Jacob's dead now. What are you going to do with us? They're scared he's going to kill them. He said, man, I ain't got nothing like that. I ain't no Esau. And Joseph is a great picture of Christ. And just so it was your sin. I ain't talking about your families. I'm talking about you individually. It's my sin individually that killed the Lord Jesus Christ. Now what is he going to do with us? You better be glad he's got mercy in his heart and he's not like Esau. The days of mourning for my father are at hand. Then will I slay my brother Jacob. He that hateth his brother is of the devil, 1 John 3 says. 1 John 3:12 said that Cain was of that wicked one and Esau just like him. And these words of Esau, her elder son, were told to Rebekah. And she sent and called Jacob, her younger son, and said unto him, behold, thy brother Esau is touching thee, doth comfort himself. And ain't this awful that the only comfort you got is murder? He doth comfort himself, proposing to kill thee. Now, therefore, my son, obey my voice, and arise, flee thou to Laban, my brother, to Haran, and tarry with him a few days until thy brother's fury turn away, until thy brother's anger turn away from thee, and he forget that which thou hast done to him. Then when it's time, I'll shoot up a flare, and you'll know. Then I will sin and fetch thee from thence. Why should I be deprived also of you both in one day? Now listen. And Rebekah said to Isaac, I am weary of my life. That's why these last two verses in Genesis 26 are so important. Abraham said, listen, you go down yonder and get a wife from where I come from for my son. I don't want these Canaanites in my house. You say, well, they knew that. Yeah. But ain't nothing like having to live in it to really know it. You didn't do it. You waited and walked in the field and meditated in the field till the camels were coming, and Rebekah lit off the camel and came, and you and her went into the mother's tent, and that's where your heart was comforted. You did what God said. You waited and did what God said. You didn't go with the lust of the flesh and the lust of the heart and pride of life and all that stuff. You weren't lured by your lust. You did what God said. But Esau didn't. And sometimes some of us Christians, I mean real, true, born again, I'm talking about going to heaven Christians, we get so adapted to the nicety of Christianity that we forget just how bad it is not to be saved. Amen. Me and my wife, my son John, and his wife, us four, no more. Everything's fine in our little... Yeah, but let God tear down that wall out from around you. And send your son John and his wife, you know, to Kalamazoo and let him have a job up there among the heathen and find out just how good it is then. Listen, dear soul, we have gone to accomplishing a sin that David talked about that none of us have ever prayed against. Lord, forgive thy servant of presumptuous sin. You just presume that it ought to be like this. Neither were they thankful, and their foolish heart was darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools. You better be careful thinking, well, this is the way it's supposed to be. Then I guess you're saying, I don't care about Jesus on the cross. That was supposed to be. He's just supposed to die for me. I ain't supposed to go to hell. That's presumptuous sin. You're presuming on God. Son, you better be careful. You better go back to where you got saved and remember how it was to be lost. Without God and without hope in the world. Wake up! Just because you know all the words to the songs and you can quote the Bible, that don't mean that Esau ain't going to drag some Hittite in there on you one of these days and God's going to wake you up. And you're going to say, man, I wish I'd listened to start with. I just presumed that everything was supposed to be like this. Mom and Daddy was. Isaac and Rebekah, that's... But hey... Now we got a murderer in among us. We got a fornicator in among us. We got a profane person in among us. We got one that prefers the satisfaction of the physical appetite above the spiritual things of God. And he's your brother, and you had to sleep on bunk beds with him. And now he's after you. How did that happen? Let both grow together, the tare and the wheat. And ain't nobody can separate it but God Almighty. Let the angels come and separate. She says, I am weary of my life. What's wrong, you woman? What are you weary of your life for? Read on. Because of the daughters of Heth. If Jacob take a wife of the daughters of Heth, such as these which are of the daughters of the land, what good shall my life do me? Can you believe that? This is the woman that said, I will go with this man. This is the one that her and her damsels got on the 10 camels and came back hundreds of miles. And as soon as she saw Isaac, she said, who is that man? And he said, that's my master. She put a veil on her face. Reverence, respect, tenderheartedness. She is just really desirous to do those things that are holy and right and just and true. But here she is now. Now she's got lines in her face. Now she's grieving. Now that the roses have gone out of her cheeks. And now she's walking around singing sad songs. And you say, what did that to you? Esau's wives. Dear soul, if you're just thinking about your children and literal marriages, you ain't getting this. That's talking about the whole church and the abomination of the unequal yokes that is brought to bear upon us. And there's more influence and effect upon every one of us, from the preacher all the way back, by the whole church and what it's done to us, what we realize. And dear soul, there ain't no joy anywhere except in Jesus Christ.
Amen. That's right.
Well, my grandson made a profession. My son made a profession. Well, I appreciate that, but that's a starting line. Let's wait to cross the finish line. Let's see how it pans out. Because everybody, you know, when the gun fires and they get off at the starting gate, they ain't the same bunch if crosses the finish line. Let's wait and see. It may not be that you've got a true salvation.
Amen. But,
God is not going to fill heaven according to mine and your bloodline. Not of him that willeth or him that runneth, but of God that showeth mercy. Those that are born of the Spirit, not just born of the flesh. And dear soul, here it is, right here, laid out. You need to be careful. You need to quit sinning the sin of supposition. I suppose, I presume God wants to. Don't presume on nothing. Because you can come to a time in your life when all that nice little religious family is just busted all to pieces, because that's all it was religion. And not spirituality. Esau was raised up in the same tent that Isaac was. Isn't that something? Let's read on down. You say we got to the end of the chapter. Well, that don't mean we got to the end of the Bible. That's Genesis 27:46. Now, next verse. And Isaac called Jacob. Boy, there ain't nothing like a grieving wife to get the daddy to stir up and do something about the kids. And Isaac called Jacob and blessed him and charged him and said unto him, thou shalt not take a wife of the daughters of Canaan. Brother, if he ain't heard that sermon before, he's hearing it now. Why? Because it's a reality now. It's an experience now. I mean, that's what God said back out there. You remember what Abraham said when he made his servant put his hand under his thigh? And you remember he said, don't take a daughter. And we got all that, you know. She even made some needlework and made a little thing and put it on the wall. Thou shalt not take a Canaanite. Ain't that pretty? All them flowers around. But it ain't going to do no good hanging on the wall, son. You got to get it in your life and in your heart. And now it takes the daughters of Heth to grieve Rebecca so bad, she says, I don't care if I live another minute. Now Isaac calls Jacob and charges him, thou shalt not. Verse 2, arise, go to Padanaram, to the house of Bethuel, thy mother's father, and take thee a wife from thence of the daughters of Laban, thy mother's brother. And he said, that's the way, verse 3, God Almighty will bless you. How serious are you, dear soul, in your marriage to Jesus? We showed you 1 Corinthians 6:17. He that's married unto the Lord is one spirit. How serious are you? Are you flirting around with the Canaanites? Are you flirting around with the world? Is the lust of the world and the pride of life and that sort of thing? Is lust leading you or the Holy Ghost? Are you pure in your attention, in your intention? Or are you just like Samson and all those guys over there in Genesis chapter 6? Well, boy, that's a good looking thing right there. I know God would want me to have one of them. You get it. Now you got to live with it.
Right.
Now you got to pay for it.
Right.
And not just pay dollar down, dollar away. You're going to have to pay for it till you hear that oneness with you say, I loathe life. Why? Because there's wild gourds in the pot. Because you reached out and got something that God said, thou shalt not. Did you realize, James chapter 4 and verse 4, did you realize that involvement with the world is adultery with God? Did you realize that? Well, we're just living a great time. We got the internet and we got, you know, cars with air conditioning on both sides, and she can set hers on Inferno, and I got mine over here on Popsicle. And man, we just do it. It's a wonderful world. Wait a minute! You got one little dumb preacher down here trying to warn you. The bridge is out. The bridge is out. Slow down. You can get rid of me. Just a few more minutes. It'll be all right. And you can go right back to what you're doing and you can embrace your daughters of Heth. It's all right. If that's what you want. But listen. James chapter 4 and verse 4. Ye adulterers and adulteresses. Well, it's a lot of risses in it. Know ye not that illicit relationships with other people is adultery? That ain't what it's saying. Listen to what it said. Ye adulterers and adulteresses, know ye not that the friendship of the world is strong ill will, enmity with God? That's that word he used over there about the snake in the garden. There'll be strong ill will, enmity between thee and thy seed and the seed of the woman. Whosoever, therefore, will be a 1, 2, 3, 4. Read them next words. Whoever, therefore, will be a... is the... I bet that ain't on your refrigerator. I bet that ain't no magnet on your refrigerator. I bet that ain't hanging from your windshield. I mean, from your rearview mirror. Well, you know, we're straight over here. We don't have none of that business. We don't go in for all that kind of stuff. Really? When you got saved, you wedded Jesus. Those that are joined to the Lord are one spirit. God calls himself in Isaiah 54, I think it's verse 5, you can look it up. Thy maker is thy husband. And this old, if you're going to understand the book of the Revelation, you're going to have to get it down to practical application in your daily life and understand what's the difference between the whore and let me show you the lamb's wife. And it shows you a city. Wasn't that a beautiful song this morning? She was singing not about Jerusalem, which is now, but the Jerusalem, which is from above. I appreciated that. I just wish she'd sing it an octave higher. If I got on the stepladder, I couldn't reach the bottom of that note. Listen, have you got time? Have you got time? Genesis chapter 2, verse 23. This is prior to the fall. This is in that glory of purity. And the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon Adam, verse 21, and he slept. And God took one of his ribs and closed up the flesh instead thereof. God's standing there holding a rib in his hand. And the rib which the Lord God had taken from man, made he or builded he a womb man and brought her unto the man. And here, as far as I know, are Adam's first words. And Adam said in joyous astonishment, "This is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. So he that loveth his wife loveth himself," because that's where she come from. Adam was made without the aid of a man or a woman, directly from God. But Eve was made with the aid of the man, with God forming her from the body of man. He said, "That's my flesh and that's my body." How do you know that? There was a revelation about the impartation of the glory of the two being one. "She shall be called womb man, because she was taken out of man. Therefore," and this is what he knew, he didn't have a Bible, "therefore shall a man leave his father and mother and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh." Adam said that upon what I think are his first recorded words. In joyful astonishment, he has his mouth opened and he brings forth this adoration equally to God and to his wife. He recognizes himself in her and recognizes herself from him. So, what's all this with the pickup truck and the, you know, can of chewing tobacco in your Levi back pocket and that pack of dogs? What's all this with them credit cards and running around with the ladies and y'all too just meet somewhere where you want to eat tonight, you know, and then you're gone again? But we're a Christian nation. We wouldn't know God if we met him in the road. We don't need the gospel. Just take marriage. This is a great mystery. That's why this is put right here. It is to reestablish the authenticity of the holiness and reverence of marriage upon the minds and hearts of Isaac and Rebekah. And God does so with this hot iron of grief that he, as it were, brands them again with to make them understand that all that back yonder, as we look in your photo album, "Oh, look how small you were. Look how little you were, sir. And look, oh, lady, look at your hair." You know, that's where they were back then, you know. And all of that, but wait a minute. What about now? The photo album don't do it. Did you understand that you were taking on God Almighty's part and saying, "World, look at me. I am a representative of Jesus Christ as to how I treat her"? And lady, did you realize when you said, "I do," that you were saying, "As he represents Jesus Christ to me, I will submit to him and represent the church back to him"? You know what? It ain't gonna work no other way. Only as he shows her Christ is she gonna show him that church's submission. And men love that verse.
Wives submit.
Well, they ain't gonna submit unless the husband's love. "Well, I love her. I gave her a ring for her birthday and gave himself." Excuse me. It ain't between her and Jared. It's between you and her and the Lord. Gave himself. It's probably going to get too personal. Shoot, man, we've already passed that, ain't we? I talked to a couple one time. They was having troubles and she kept saying my money, and he kept saying my money. And come to find out them Jaybirds had two separate checking accounts. I hope ain't nobody in here like that, because I'm going to get in deep trouble. What in the world are you talking about? If you give yourself, what difference does it matter what's back here in your back pocket? I don't care. I go up to the cash register at the store, and the lady said, that'd be so much money, and so many. I just hold my money out, and I say, you take what you need. And the sack boy looks at me like, well, are you crazy? I said, son, I've been married 55 years. I've learned, I'm domesticated as they get. Just hold it out and let her get what she wants. And hope there's something left for me to go to Judy's and get grits. You ain't going to give your money if you ain't give yourself. Come on now. Ain't that right?
Amen.
But I represent Jesus. Okay, so you want Jesus to hold back the payment he made for you at Calvary. You want him to hold back his money. Well, wait a minute, that ain't going to work so good. Jesus' money and your money. Guess what? You ain't only, not only do you not have no money, you're bankrupt. You ain't got nothing. In fact, you owe everything. You ain't just broke, zero. You're in debt, minus. How are you going to pay God what you owe him if Jesus does what you do? And you're saying, I want Jesus to be to me the way I am to her. No, that ain't what I'm saying. Yes, you are. Wives, if you women don't get together and vote me in a race, you ought to be whipped. Just kidding, I'm fine. They offered me a raise last Saturday and I told them I didn't need nothing. I'm fine. How do we close this out? Two passages. Christ's Bride, Revelation 21. Revelation 21. And this puts us into overtime, so this will help you with your second service today. Revelation 21:9, there came unto me one of the seven angels which had the seven vials full of the seven last plagues, and talked with me, saying, come hither, I will show thee the bride, the Lamb's wife. Isn't it amazing? It's the ones with the last plagues that's going to destroy everything there is outside of Christ. And they say, let me show you the Lamb's wife. And he carried me away into the Spirit, into a great and high mountain. He's elevating into the Holy Spirit, into the things which are not seen. Showed me that great city, Curran, the holy Jerusalem, descending out of heaven from God. When did that happen? Pentecost. And suddenly there was a sound of a rushing mighty wind descending, right? It's the church having the glory of God. That's the first thing about Christ's bride, having the glory of God. He doesn't retain his glory for himself exclusively. Listen, no flesh shall glory in my presence. God is jealous of his glory, but he doesn't hold it back from his wife. Having the glory of God, and her light was like unto a stone most precious. She had a wall in verse 12 that walled her in and walled other things out. He took care of her, protected her, nourished her. A garden enclosed is my sister, my spouse. Song of Solomon chapter 5 and verse 12. Chapter 4 and verse 12. Chapter 5 and verse 1. Let the north wind and the south wind blow that her spices may fill the atmosphere. She's enclosed, but I can send the Spirit and cause those spices of the fruit of the Spirit to go forth and enhance her love to me. We ain't got time to read all of this. Look at Revelation 17. This is the whore's. This is a great whore, Satan's bride. And there came one of the seven angels which had the seven vials, here they are again, and talked with me, saying unto me, come hither, I will show unto thee the judgment of the great whore that sitteth upon many waters. Verse 15 says, the waters are everybody in the world, the people, with whom the kings of the earth have committed what Esau does. fornication. You see, religion's all about fornication, but the spiritual union with Christ is about love. And the inhabitants of the earth have been made drunk with the wine of her fornication. So he carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness, and I saw a woman sit upon a scarlet-colored beast full of names of blasphemy, with seven heads and 10 horns. But look how she's arrayed, like a harlot. She raised her hemline and lowered her neckline and attracts through wantonness. And the woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet colored and bedecked and decked with gold and precious stones and pearls, having a golden cup in her hand full of abomination and filthiness of her fornication. Upon her forehead was a name written. She's a city too. Mystery. Not the great mystery, but mystery. Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots and abominations of the earth. And even John said in the last part of verse 6, and when I saw her, I wondered with great admiration. And the angel got on to him and said, what are you doing staring at that woman? He said, I ain't never seen nothing like that. And he said, that's what you got now, that the Holy Ghost has come. For not only is there going to be birthed, a bride for Isaac, a bride for Jacob, but there's also going to be the daughters of Heth for Esau. Folks, the gospel is closer to you than what you realize. You say, well, they don't sit under the sound of the gospel. Oh, yeah, they do. You say, well, they don't go to church. Okay, now I'll agree with you on that. But they got the gospel. Are they here on earth? Somebody got married or they wouldn't be here. They might not be married yet, but somebody came to a union or they wouldn't be here. Everybody knows about marriage. It's the great mystery. And just to make sure, and you know, I don't have the palate of Brother Kenny. He can eat molten lava and say, man, this is good. I don't even want red pepper on my stuff. Black pepper, some of it's too spicy. But God wants to put the spice of the daughters of Heth in this holy family. Let it burn your tongue a little bit. Come to understand, you better be thankful for what you got, because you didn't get it for yourself. God did. And by the way, you can't keep it for yourself. Only God can. And if you talk to some of these families around here that's got some of the daughters of Heth mixed in with them, you'll find out. You can't say, well, because I'm a Christian. No, 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 no. Do you know about Christ and his church? Are you serious about your union with God? God have mercy.